Well, here we are once again, and yesterday, after I got done making that little math video, I thought to myself, I forgot to mention anything about like computing heat loadings and stuff like that. So I thought, okay, I'll just make another little presentation and cover those subjects. And I know y'all have seen this all before, but this is just by way of review. And the reason this is important is because of tube capacity. Any X-ray tube, and ordinarily I don't read to y'all, but I will this time. All X-ray tubes have a maximum capacity, and modern control panels, they have like breaker switches in there. Basically, it's the computer knows how much heat and how much energy its particular tube can handle, and it's not going to let you exceed that limit. So if you dial some crazy technique, like really high KVP and really high MA, and you go to make your exposure, it's possible that the computer will stop you. It'll just give you an error message. It's not going to let you fry the tube with a crazy technique. And most of the time, what's going on is, you've got your KVP set correctly because we're all pretty much in agreement on those. But you might have your MA dialed up too high, like if you're trying to reduce motion or something, and so you're trying to make your time really, really low, and you've got your MA set to like 800 and your KVP set to 120, then it's conceivable that your control panel may balk at that. Anyway, all you got to do is just back your MA down until the computer says it's okay, and then make your exposure. And as we're going to see, as your KVP goes up, your MA has to go down, because the two sides of the equation have to balance. So every X-ray tube comes with a tube rating chart. Now, these things differ by manufacturer, but the basic premise of these things is always the same. Basically, what you're going to do is you're going to look at your tube rating chart, and it's going to have some lines and curves, and you just have to plot on the chart where your technique lies, and if it's below the curve, then you're good. If you're above the curve, then chances are you're not going to be able to make that exposure. Every tube and I guess I should say every tube has at least one rating chart, because there's a separate chart for small filament and large filament, and you have to make sure you're looking at the right one, in order to be able to do anything with it. And the faster your anode can spin, the more heat your tube can tolerate, so that plays into it too. So you'll have to look at the chart for your correct focal spot size and anode rotation. So here's a critical thinking question. We're supposed to be all about critical thinking. Which has a larger heat capacity, small focal spot or large focal spot? And why? How come that is? We'll answer this in our discussion board for next week. Okay, so here's a cartoon rating chart that I purloined out of Bouchon's book. And this isn't from any particular manufacturer. I mean, supposedly it's from GE Healthcare, but I can't imagine that GE Healthcare would have such a cartoonish heat rating chart. I'm going to show you guys a real one in just a minute. But if you'll take a look here, and I don't know if y'all can see my cursor or not, but suppose that we've got a tube with an anode rotation of 3400, and it's a single phase machine, and we're using the small focal spot, 0.6 millimeter, and it's got an 11 degree target angle. Okay, so if I want to use 100 kVp for some exposures, what is the most time that I can the most time I can expose if I've dialed 150 MA? Well, all I got to do is follow this line out. There's my cursor. Okay, at 100 kVp, and if I go across here to where it intersects the 150 MA line, that's going to put me at 0.1, so 1/10 of a second. That's the longest exposure I can make if I've set 150 MA and 100 kVp. Now, suppose I'm insisting on using 100 kVp, but I want to go like 0.5 seconds. So 0.5 seconds would be right out here somewhere. And there's my 100 line. So here it goes. Now at 150 mA, I'm unsafe because I'm on top of that line. However, if I dial my mA back to 100, then that's going to put me right here. That's well below the 100 mark, so I can make that exposure. Okay, so that's kind of how the whole thing works. So if we look over at this rating chart here, this tube has an anode that can spin at 10,000 RPM, and it's got a 1 millimeter, so this is the large focal spot, and this is for three phase. So I've got a three phase generator with a large focal spot and a high speed anode. And so in this case, if I'm trying to use 100 kVp, well, I'm good to go. You know, as long as I'm using, let's see, what is this? Okay, this is 250 mA. So on this, I don't even have the 150 mA line. That would be like way out here to the right somewhere. So at 100 kVp, I can use, you know, if I'm using 300 mA, then I can go all the way out here to probably like 5 seconds, which would be a ridiculously long exposure time. But that just goes to show how much more power this tube can stand as compared to this one. Okay, now here's what a real tube rating chart looks like. This is the Dell Medical tube rating chart that comes from the machine in our laboratory. So this is the X-ray machine that we use all the time, you know, to make exposures. And there we go. Nope, wait, I wanted to see if I could zoom that thing. I think there's a way to do that. Okay, there is a way to zoom it, but the way my control panel's set up, I can't get to it right this minute. So anyway, we'll just have to put our glasses on and go after this thing. Now, check this out. This tube rating chart is set up differently. Instead of having kVp up the left side, we've got the mA going up the left, and our mA goes from 100 up to 1000. Okay, and then our kV is over here on this curve, and once again our time is across the bottom. So if I wanted to use 100 kVp, then I would look at this curve right here. That one. Okay, now at 100 kVp, if I want to use an exposure time of 0.1 second, then if I follow that guy, where's my cursor? If I follow that line out to where the 0.1 second mark is, that means that I can use at most about 500 mA. Okay, so my mA station is going to have to be relatively low in order for me to be able to achieve this exposure that I'm wanting to use. So if I wanted to use, say I was just like bound and determined to have a 1 second exposure time. So here's the 1 second line. And if I go up here, then where does the 100 K line cross? Right about there. So I would be able to only use like 300 mA. I would have to reduce my mA way down. And again, check this out. Okay, this focal spot is 1.5. That's a large focal spot. And over here, we see that the focal spot is 0.6. So if you look, the 0.6 focal spot has a lot less capacity than the 1.5. Small focal spot is generally, well, always weaker. But that's okay, because with small focal spot, we're using small technique, right? We're typically using like 60, 70, 80 kVp because we're imaging, you know, skull or extremities. We're not typically doing abdominal or chest work using the small focal spot. So if you take a look out here at the small focal spot, and if I find my 100 kV line, right there it goes. Okay, so even at like a 1/100th of a second exposure time, I can only use about 200 mA. So my mA is going to be greatly reduced out here using the small focal spot. Again, that's fine. You know, we don't typically use 100 kVp for extremities anyway. We're going to probably be using like 70. And as you can see, at 70 kVp, I'm allowed to go up to almost 300 mA on a short exposure time. And this curve, you know, is not all that steep. So I can go out, I can have like a 1/10th of a second exposure time at 3, Yeah, 300 MA is what it looks like. Oops, I accidentally advanced to the next slide, but that's all right. Okay, once again, here's another one of these charts, and say I ask a question like, okay, at 200 MA and 80 kVp, is it going to be safe or unsafe for me to use a 0.3 second exposure time? Well, let's plot it out. Okay, here's 80 kVp, and if I'm going across to 0.3 seconds, right there it is, and that is above the 200 MA line, which means that that is unsafe. And that's how these questions on the registry will typically be posed. They'll say something like, you know, given these factors, is it safe or unsafe? And if you plot your point and it's above the curve, then it's unsafe. If it's below the curve, then it's safe. So if I'm choosing 150 MA and 100 kVp and 0.1 second, is that going to be safe or unsafe? Okay, well, here's my 100. And I go over here to 0.1, and it is below the 150 curve, totally safe. But if I dial that up to 200 MA, unsafe. Computer's probably not going to let me do it. Okay, now, next thing I wanted to remind you guys of is heat unit computations. And to come up with heat units, it's just kVp times MA times seconds, and then multiplied by a constant. Now, for single phase, true single phase hardware, that constant is just 1.0. So all you have to do is just multiply your kVp and your mass. So you're good to go for that. Now, for three phase and high frequency units, just use this 1.4. It's not going to be exact, but it's going to put you in the ballpark. There are different constants for different kinds of generators. You know, whether you're using like three phase six pulse or three phase 12 pulse or high frequency, but 1.4 is a good kind of like a good catch-all for those. And on the registry, they're just going to want you to be in the ballpark anyway. They just want to know if you know what they're talking about. So, for example, if I have 80 kVp exposure at 400 MA and 0.1 seconds on a single phase generator, my heat units would be just straight up 80 times 40, because 400 times 0.1 is 40. So 80 times 40 times 1 is 3,200 heat units. Now, if I swap that out and I say, okay, instead of a single phase generator, now we're going to be on a three phase generator or a high frequency, then I would need to use this constant of 1.4. So I would do the same computation, 80 times 40, 80 kVp times 40 mass, but then I'm going to multiply that by my 1.4 constant, and that's going to give me 4480. So with more efficient equipment, you do generate a lot more heat at the anode, but that's okay because the anodes are designed to handle that additional heat, and it's really good for the patient because your X-ray output is much more consistent and your images are better. Now, heat units aren't really important in diagnostic, and the reason for that is because think about the way it works, right? Okay, so you've got your patient, and you got your patient in there for a PA chest X-ray, and so you run around to the control panel and you make your exposure, right? And then in just like a few seconds, your exposure comes up on the control panel, on the display, and you see, okay, cool, you know, that worked. So then you run back into the room and you turn your patient to the, you know, so that their left side's against the board. And now you're all set up for your lateral chest X-ray. So you go back to the control panel. Well, by the time you do all that nonsense, your tube has pretty much had time to cool off. You know, so regardless of what you're shooting X-rays at, you're not going to max out this tube because there's just too much time in between exposures. Now think about the case of a CT scan, which is you're using high kVp, and you've got this anode rotating around, or your tube is spinning around the patient. And every time it goes around the patient, it's taking about 25 exposures. And then how many revolutions does it make per second? I'm not sure, but it's a bunch. So you're probably taking like 100, 150 exposures per second. And so that's going to make your tube get really hot. So your heat loading is going to be important there. Same kind of thing when you're using a C-arm or if you're using a fluoro tower. If the doctor goes live on the fluoro and, you know, he just like hits the expose switch and just keeps it down, then that tube's going to start getting hot pretty quick. And I've actually seen C-arms shut down because the heat got too high. Okay, so here's your anode cooling curve. Now, in this case, we've got a mock-up of a cooling curve where the maximum heat loading capacity is 350,000 heat units. So the way this thing works is if my tube is heated up to the max, it's got the 350,000 heat units, then if I'm going to wait for that thing to cool off, in this particular case, it looks like that tube is going to need 15 minutes approximately to cool completely off, right? But a lot of times if you're looking at these questions on the registry, they'll say, look, this tube is at 350. How long do we have to wait before we can apply another 100,000 to it? Okay, well, that's pretty easy to figure out. You say, well, 350 minus 100,000 is how long we have to wait. So 350 minus 100,000 is 250,000. So we have to wait until the tube gets to this point here, and then we can hit it and push it right back up to this point. So if we are going to wait until it gets down to 250, it looks like that's going to take us about 2 minutes. You know, and this is a very rough graph. A lot of times the ones that you'll be given will be a little bit more detailed, or they might say something to the effect of, you know, if it's charged up to 300, then how long do we have to wait until we can apply 200 to it? Well, what you have to do is like figure, okay, 300, that looks like about 1 minute, and 200 is going to put me down to the 100,000 mark. So that's going to be about 3 minutes. 3 minus 1. Okay, so I'm going to need to wait about 2 more minutes. And it's in, you know, it's pretty rough. You know, you just kind of have to figure in whole numbers generally. They're not going to want to know like 2.3 minutes or anything like that. They just want to know if you know how to read these charts or not. And if you do, then you can answer any of these questions. Okay, cool. So that's my quick and dirty review of these tube rating charts. And I'm going to put a Blackboard quiz up for you guys that you'll have to do by the end of next week. And that'll be for a grade, so don't blow it off. All right, y'all. Oh, yeah, discussion board. Don't forget to do your discussion boards whenever those things are live, because that's going to be part of your attendance grade, too.